At every stage in our existence, we're all going to be part of systems. Our schools, our families, our business places, our workplaces. Even time itself is a system. From the beginning of time to today, January 2020 is only a part of, because it's a system of time. But one thing runs supreme or runs consistent across this system, operated or driven by man, is the fact that every man created from the beginning of time wants to be happy. No wonder our very own Timaya has been able to inspire and rouse up a whole generation of people, including my ageless mother who is here, to think along and say, I can't kill myself, allow me to flex. This desire is in every man. This desire inspires us to not want to go through the rigors of life to participate in this, but at the center of this desire also lies a problem. The fact that we are all seemingly running away from these systems. We're running away from bad marriages, bad relationships. We're running away from bad government. We're even running away from our village people. And everybody tells you, my village people after me. But the truth is, our society has placed an enormous responsibility on every member of its system. And that pressure is this desire to show up, to appear, to be like, be one like the Joneses, what I call the Instagram desire to belong. Now, this same desire ignores something so fundamental and unique, something that runs through the beginning of time till today, and that's what I call process. Process is a universal principle. The universe as we have it was founded and is sustained by process. So whether you believe in God or whether you believe the world as it is came from the Big Bang theory, the world we have today is a system that has become what it is because one person, three people have contributed a part and have continued to do something. We had men and women who had dreams. Graham Bell had a dream to connect people in the world. But Graham Bell didn't see iPhone 11. So many people we have in our systems in the past dreamt, but they never saw it. My grandparents of my grandfathers of blessed memory. My mom's father had 9 of them, no 10, and one passed on. I'm just a secondary school teacher with a grandmother who was just managing. But the truth is, they believed in their reality. They lived the reality they believed in. They didn't think of life as something that had to happen unfold once. They lived their life in part. And today my grandfather, though not here, has lived his part. And has been able to inspire and raise a daughter who is a national coordinator in the World Health Organization. That was what he did. In 1972, a young man who had just finished his studies in the United States of America, inspired by a desire to help transform his country that was falling into deep chaos, went back to Bangladesh. And because of his position, he was given a prominent role in government. He was bored. And what he did was to pick up a teaching opportunity in a university somewhere in Chittagong, Bangladesh. So from where he lives to Chittagong University, a small town of Jobra, separated those 2 points. And what he realized between 1972 and 1976 was the fact that the city of Jobra had arable land and that the people were very poor. Now, mind you, he was an economics professor, so he was meant to understand and see how economies should grow. But he said he was bored by the fact that the theories he was teaching had no meaning on the people of Chittagong and by extension the people of Jokra. Now, I want to remind you that he left the United States of America, the comfort of the United States, all with this nationalistic and patriotic zeal to go back to Bangladesh. Today, by just picking the few people around him, by just lowering his perspective, he just looked around him and he picked his students and they set up a small system within their system. Today, Grameen Bank is one of the biggest microfinance institutions. And the man we are talking of today is someone I consider a mentor, Mohammed Yunus. We are going to have things that will put us under pressure. Today we live in a world where young children are sent off to school before they're even able to speak. Children are sent to school and taught things that would take the childhood from them. Young girls and young boys are just told to get married, have a fantastic wedding and please your parents and your community people. And young boys are told that if you don't make it, then you're not part of the society. And even our churches no longer even inspire confidence. I remember one of my late uncles, Uncle Jude, during the Christmas festivities, Uncle Jude would come with the biggest yam and he would be applauded like the next person who gave 100,000 naira. But today, I bet you, if you come to church with your yam, nobody will look at you. The pastor, the priest, the imams, nobody will listen to you. So the society is telling you, putting you under some sort of pressure, that however you make it, it's okay. If you go to Malaysia, you go to South Africa, it's okay. Now society is also telling us that the young woman who sells akara, who has been selling akara for 20 years and has been able to send her children, take them through school, that she's not as important as the man who somehow one goes his way and gets into government. And this pressure is making us more frustrated and is leaving our small systems, our families, our schools depressed. A WHO report in 2015 calculated that the world has 322 million depressed people. 9.19 million of these people live in Africa. 7 million of these people live in Nigeria. And that was 2015. In 2017, we had already started hearing of depression and suicide, something that was alien to us a while ago. And somebody will say, is it because we don't have money? But I would juggle your memory. In 2018, the Forbes Rich List, which started in 2015, published that Africa had produced 24 billionaires. Now I'm talking of 24 billionaires in dollar terms. And we have expanding economies. Yes, we're having more people slipping into depression. And the truth is, unless we go back to the drawing board, unless we embrace this culture of process, unless parents go back home and start telling their children, it's okay to be diligent, it's okay to work hard. Okay, your result might not be fantastic, but I love your work ethic. And until the governors and until the politicians start recognizing people who give their all for the system, not necessarily people who contribute the most at the campaign rally, we keep having people under pressure to just appear. So today, I'm only here to remind us that the universe as we have it respects process. And the universe, the moment you betray the universe's principle, the universe fights back immediately. Everything we have today is a function of process. It doesn't take so much. It's as little as entering a cab and smiling at the cabman and greeting him from your heart. I do that quite a lot, and the results have been phenomenal. You enter and you tell a cabman, good morning. You don't have so much to give him, but you tell him, good morning, sir. How was your night? How is business? And naturally, the average Nigerian will say, oh, my brother, it's tough. And then you tell him, I know it's tough, I'm also living the reality of being a Nigerian, but the truth is, you're alive. You have a car. at the very least. At least to ensure that we are not going to beg hungry. There are so many people who don't have that. Until we lower our gaze. Because the truth is, many of us have breezed life with our 360-degree frame. So we raise our heads and we turn around. The truth is, we see opportunities. But because we live in a social media era, it is only going to help us see so many challenges, and that's probably going to make us feel like we have not done much. But if we could just use our 90-degree or 45-degree frame, so you look down and you turn around, so you see less of the challenges, but you're able to realize that to change or inspire happiness, that you just need to look at your locality. That's why I believe that happiness is local. It's not about where you're from. It's about the fact that we live in floating localities. Wherever you are is your locality. And if you could just bend your head down a bit and look around you, starting from yourself, to remind yourself that you are enough. Maybe, just maybe, your life will light up another life and another life. And you don't necessarily see the end of it, because there is nothing like there. The there my grandfather hoped for is already here. And here is only going to inspire another day. So I urge you all to live your days in the today. To embrace the lifestyle of process. And to make that journey from your heart to the next person. To the next person. Thank you.